How's it? Welcome to episode 24 of the Same Old Arsenal USA. And you know what the worst feeling in the world is? Burning your tongue on soup that is practically lava. But that's all I'm going to say on that. We're going to get into, is the glass half full? Is the glass half empty? You tell us in the comments. But first, we are going to listen to this.
West Cork Beard Company make beard oil and beard balm for a strong, healthy, great looking beard. Handmade from all natural ingredients in Clonakilty, West Cork. Check out their YouTube channel for beard care tips and advice, or catch them online at westcorkbeardcompany.ie.
I swear I have absolutely nothing to do with getting the beard company involved in this. So, how are we this evening, gents? Ryan, how are things? Are you muted?
Yeah.
It was funny. I was unmuted, and then the ad came on. I'm like, I got to make sure I'm muted in case I say something, even though I know it automatically mutes me, but you know, better safe than sorry. Yeah, I'm doing good. I'm actually a lot better now that my spirit animal is here alive in the flesh making his Same Old Arsenal USA debut. And I couldn't be any happier. I'm smitten.
Jesus. Stan, how are you, my friend?
I'm good. Just been very busy with work and looking forward to chatting with you all this evening.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And making his long-awaited, I don't know if it's long-awaited or not, Same Old Arsenal USA debut, the one, the only Mike Hernandez from Not Another Arsenal Podcast. Mike, how are you, my friend? Thank you for stepping up and filling in here tonight with us.
Of course, man. Pleasure to be on. I listen to you guys all the time. Love interacting with you guys on Twitter. So you guys are all top people. So glad to be here. Thanks for the invitation.
Except for Ryan. I mean, the jury's out, so we just kind of feel bad for him and bring him along. So.
Ryan set the bar so high for me. I feel like just dipping out now. I don't think I could do justice.
Wow.
The way he props me up, man.
I want to shout out everybody in the – well, let me shout out Gary moderating the chat first, and then I'm going to turn it over to Stan for his – at least the first half of his weekly duties anyway. So go ahead and shout out the chat, Stan.
Let's see, we've got him joining us tonight. We've got Gary in there moderating. Big Mike from the Gooners podcast. Thanks for coming in. Footboy Brownie's in there. Tell me this, tell you this. Tell me this, tell you this is joining us. BX Gunner 81. Mike Hertz is in there as well, even though he's here. Two places at once.
Yeah.
And I think that's it just for the moment. Thanks to everyone for coming in.
Yeah, and I'm sure we'll add to this total as the night goes on. And I'm playing through a bit of pain right now. I went out last night to a buddy of mine's bar, had some dinner, and I had some French onion soup. And you could almost smell it continuing to cook in the crock. And I took a tried to cool it off, blow on it, whatever. And I took a bite. It was just, oh my God, it was just scalding. So like all day long, I've done nothing but look at my tongue in the mirror and like get some burn spray to like spray on my tongue and whatnot. Oh, it's awful. It's the worst. It's like, seriously, it's one of the worst feelings in the world, but fantastic. If anybody is ever in Pittsburgh or anybody's actually watching this show from Pittsburgh, Smoking Joe's in the South Side, baby corner, 20th and Carson, go check them out. Great beer and obviously good food. Stan, you want to shout out the little rodent? Because he just
the football gerbil's just crept into the house. Welcome.
Yeah.
Good evening, Senior Gerbil.
He's very quiet. You don't really hear him when he comes in. He's very small.
He scuttles in.
Exactly. Somebody want to get his wheel set up though to keep him busy so he can just run the entire show and anyway.
Okay. Gerbil, can you please confirm Bellerin?
I need confirmation on these Bellerin rumors. I guess that's just about as good a place as any to start. And Stan, I'm going to start with you because that's your boy, Hector Bellerin. Rumors are he wants out, doesn't want to spend the prime of his career, I guess, at Arsenal. Paris are once again seeming to renew their interest in him. Also heard Barcelona might be tabling some interest as well. How you feel? How you feel about it?
I've never, as I say, he's never been a player that I felt, you know, when we're looking at the team and we're looking at surgery, major surgery of the team, he's always someone that I felt could still be waiting, you know, waiting on the next operating table. He doesn't need immediate surgery there. But on the same thing as well, I've always felt that because of the length of time that he's now been at Arsenal, maybe there might be a little bit of staleness kind of creeping in there, you know, on both parts to freshen up in that position. And even for Hector as well, to maybe, you know, go and play his trade somewhere else. But I do think that I see the way a lot of people, better. It's funny, right? Because everybody knows how I used to be about Ozil. Mm-hmm. Do you know what I mean? I was on that, everyone knows how I used to be. And it's quite funny now because I kind of see it a little bit with Hector. And I'm kind of like on the other side of the fence. And I'm looking at some of the stuff and I'm like, have I missed something? Is he really that terrible from what I can see here? And I just kind of think that the way that he plays the game, the way that he's playing his position at the moment, is really integral to what Mikel Arteta, how he wants his fullbacks to play. And I mentioned it on the last podcast where I brought in the word mirroring. You know, what's going on with the left fullback is not identical what's going on with the right fullback. And I think that whoever comes in and takes up that position, you'll probably see them playing in a similar way. Coming in that inside channel, maybe neglecting their defensive duties, we can only keep our fingers crossed that if that person that does come in to replace Hector has a little bit more quality with their end product, a little bit more quality with their crossing, and maybe a little bit more quality with their finishing and decision-making. But you're probably going to see them playing in a similar way, in a similar fashion to what Hector is. So my hope is that if he does get moved on, we upgrade with someone who's got some better skills, a little bit more better skills. But as I've said, I've never felt that it was major surgery at this time.
Yeah, I definitely think there are other areas that we, you know, should be focusing on in terms of the transfer window. But as I've said with Hector Bellerin, you know, if a proper offer comes in for him, you got to sell him. There's nobody in this club. There's nobody in this club that's untouchable, in my opinion.
I think you take the word proper out. Just if an offer comes in.
Well, no, I mean, because I'm not taking 15 million pounds for him.
Why not?
Because how are you going to replace him with 15 million pounds? Yeah. How do you upgrade Hector Bellerin for 15 million pounds? You don't.
Curious. Okay.
In my opinion, you don't. Go ahead, Mike.
No, I think that's what you said. I don't feel like letting a player go, whether he wants to or not, or selling him for the sake of selling him, just because he's been here for a long time is the right thing to do. Either you have somebody that could replace him, or you keep on to him as long as you think he's a starter. But I don't think, similar to what Stan said, right back is the least in my mind. I'm looking at midfield. I'm looking at center forward. Backup goalie, we got to get it sorted in a sense, right? Assuming maybe Ryan just sticks with us. I'm looking at like three, possibly four positions before I even look at right back, to be completely honest. And it's not that I'm trying to big up or defend Bellerin, because I understand what people's opinions are of him. He is kind of average at both defending and attacking as of recent. He used to be a little bit more offensively witty. He seems to have lost that, or he's just, you know, lack of concentration, whatever you want. Cedric seems to be a little bit more balanced as right back. Bellerin might be suited a little bit more as right wing back. Like when we were playing five at the back, he seemed a little bit more free because it was a little bit less defensive duties that he had. But yeah, I'm kind of caught between Tanner and Stan here in that sense that I agree with Stan that he's not a priority as far as upgrading goes in right back position. But I also agree with Tanner in the sense that we can't, even if it's like 20 mil, I don't care that it's 20 mil. I want to know, what are you going to do with the 20 mil to replace and upgrade? Because that's the ultimate thing, right? Because we need to upgrade. We don't just want to get rid of players because we want to get rid of players. That's not, you know, proper team building. So totally agree with both of you guys there in that sense.
Right. I mean, two things that are, you know, somewhat opposed to one another can exist at the same time. And I think that's kind of, I'm not, and I want to, I guess maybe clarify my stance on it. I'm not itching to get rid of Hector Bellerin. I think he put in an absolute shit performance on Sunday against City. That was what I saw from him. The almost assist, was the almost goal, not assist. That was Pepe. But what I saw when Pepe put that ball to him and he just stopped running and put his hands up like this. And I kind of joked after the game, like maybe he thought he was going to commit a foul and Manchester City were going to get a penalty. And it's not that far-fetched considering how awful the officiating has been this year in the Premier League. Maybe they would have given Manchester City a penalty if Hector Bellerin makes contact in their box. But it was a pretty bad performance from him. And yeah, I think if you get a proper offer, you got to entertain it. But you're absolutely right, Stan. I'm going to come back to you on it. you're absolutely right, Mike, that it's about reinvesting that money and replacing, because I don't think if Bellerin walks out the door this year, does anybody really trust Cedric to be the guy to play the majority of the games next season at right back for us? And Stan, I want to get your opinion on it. Is there a drop dead number for you on Hector Bellerin that you say that I'm not taking any less than that for him if I don't get a better offer than he stays?
You just said something. You must have been reading my mind, because I was just thinking, you know, if Hector Bellerin goes, is there a case then that Cedric is the replacement and we look to buy an understudy for Cedric, which would be a cheaper option, you know, to be an understudy? I mean, I still haven't really seen, for me personally, I really still haven't seen enough of Cedric to say one way or the other. He's had some good games at right back. I mean, remember, he scored in his debut as well, you know. So I'm not saying that he's not good enough. We definitely need to buy someone to go ahead of him. I'd like to see a little bit more of him to make a decision. But I mean, who are the ones that are out there? There's a few names in there, like BX Gunners talking about Lamptey and Bissouma. And it was quite funny because when I saw someone, I can't remember who it was, one of the in-the-know people tweeting about it. He said that Arsenal have made, they're already feeling out a few people, and they mentioned Lamptey and Bissouma, but Lamptey's recently signed a contract. But the other one made me chuckle.
Yeah.
Because, you know, the one that made me chuckle was, you know, when you see, like, art imitating life, for probably the last three or four FIFAs, the person that I usually buy as an upgrade or understudy and then to take over from Bellerin is Youssef Attal. I think he's at Nice. And then I saw that name was mentioned and I was kind of like, yeah, I'd like that just because.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, you know when people sort of answer one of your tweets and they go, what are you talking about, mate? This ain't FIFA. Well, it would be.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
If we got him. So.
Yeah, but wait a minute. Maybe I'm onto something here.
So, yeah, but you asked me if there's a number.
Yeah, yeah. 20 million?
I would say kind of like 20 million would be nice. You know, you could maybe add a little bit there for an upgrade, you know. You could maybe add a little bit on there. Thinking that Kieran Tierney cost us 25 million. So maybe 20 million, somewhere around that mark, would be nice. What would I be content with? I mean, when we said 15 million earlier, I agree with you what you said, Tanner. It's like, well, how's that going to get spent? That doesn't buy you an upgrade. So we're going to have to chip in a little bit on top of that, or are we spending that on an understudy to Cedric? So,
right. Ryan, drop that number for you on him. I mean, you said 15 million. Is that, I mean, are you taking just about any offer that comes in for him? I mean, realistically,
it's such a tough situation because, especially after listening to you guys, I agree with all three of you in a way, and then I disagree with all three of you in a way. I mean, when you look – and I can't believe – I'm Gary, again, man, just cover your ears. Like, I don't want to say this, but he's – over the last few games, he's probably easily the worst player on the field for us, like starting 11-wise. And it's not even really that close. And I was always beating that Xhaka drum pretty loudly, but He's putting, I mean, he didn't play well against Benfica, and he was pretty good against Man City. But yeah, I've been beating that Xhaka drum, but he's not playing that bad. You know, he's putting in performances. Hector, I think, just he doesn't suit what we want to do, especially when he's played with Pepe, which I think going forward, it's not something we want to do either. We ideally want to put Pepe on the left, Saka on the right. But even with Saka, I don't see it. And kind of to Mike from the Gooners Pod's point, you know, I think Cedric is a good plug-in. I do. I agree with that. I wish the season had just started, because what I would personally do is I would just play Cedric as much as we can, and then you plug Bellerin in like a cup game, Europa League, you know, Dundalk game, and just see like if he's up for it. But you know, if he's trying to leave, teams want him, especially a team, I don't want to say prestigious, but a team that's willing to spend money like PSG, I'm pretty sure we can get a deal done to where both parties are satisfied. PSG isn't known to be cheap. So I think we just need to play our cards, you know, close to the vest, but you know, still, you know, kind of play nice a little bit, because I think getting rid of him is probably our best option. And as far as, but then again, I'm going to contradict myself right now. You know, we really don't have, that's the one thing I think, as far as our academy is concerned, the one thing we don't really have, we don't have fullbacks that could just come in. You know, Ozzy Tutu is, he's lightweight. He's small. I don't know. He's definitely not ready to get first team minutes. On the left was Abba. I can't even say his name, but he is. Long story short, I know too late. We don't have any proper fullbacks that can take his place. It's really Cedric or bust. And that's why, like, also, too, thinking about this conversation, it's getting me more and more annoyed about AMN. He has to play in the midfield. Yeah, he had a good game for West Brom in the midfield recently. I forget who they played. I don't know. Who cares? But, He was someone that I think could compete for that right back spot. I think he should have that right back spot. And Cedric, like Mike said, should be that plug-in spot. But it's just, again, we're just dancing in circles, you know.
Can I ask you a question, Ryan? Because you watch a lot of the younger generation at Arsenal quite a bit, and it was someone that mentioned it. I think Dave mentioned it. Ossie Tutu. What can you tell us about him? I've seen the name mentioned in that. He's a fullback, right? He's on loan.
Yeah, I was just talking about him. I think he's too small. He's too lightweight.
All right, so I was talking about Hector then. Sorry.
Yeah, no. Yeah, so I don't know. I do want to see him maybe in our preseason and maybe get him some early games, but I don't think he's going to really do anything for us here. You know, he was okay in the second league in Germany, and now I don't even know where he is now. Is he in the Championship or is he in League One?
No idea.
I forget where he is, but he's he's not setting the world on fire. So, and especially like on top of that, with him, with his stature being so small, and I don't think he's not one to bang with the boys. So
because you know, usually if you've got a double barreled name, that's like
Cardiff.
Cardiff.
And yeah.
He's like Cardiff Brownie. That's your guy, man. That's your Brownie.
Yeah, he has been hurt all season. It sucks because we talked about it on the after show after the Man City game. You know, you talk about what do we need? What is the one position we need to sign? I think the one person I'm getting rid of is Bellerin, but then in the same respect, it's not a necessity. A striker takes precedent. A center midfielder takes precedent, you know? So you kind of just got to – something's got to give. Either you hold on to him and you maybe can raise his value. Maybe you need cover, so he's got to stick around. Or you make some plug-in plays. You make some, like Sam was saying, some cheap replacements. Maybe an understudy for Cedric, which honestly I don't think is that bad of an option, because I don't think Cedric's – I think Cedric's playing good enough to where he could be our guy for maybe at least till January of next season, the next transfer window. And maybe we could make a move there. But it's – again, I think right back is just not a priority for us. It's not something that we need to really dive into. but it sucks to say that because, like I said, every game for the most part, even the game was Leeds, even the game that Hector scored in, he was not good. People think, oh, no. Just because he scored, I mean, he did not play well. He just happened to score a goal. Congratulations, you know. So I think that's like kind of. I'm kind of struggling with that myself because he's consistently one of, if not the worst player on the pitch. And again, I think that's also tailored to the fact that the way we play does not suit him. I think he could be a lot better given another team.
See, I like the idea that he brings something different than Kieran Tierney. Tierney's a guy that's going to bomb down the side, the left side, and put it across. Here and there might cut back in on his right foot like we saw against West Brom and just, you know, stick his middle finger up in the air to everybody and say, you know, sit down, boys, I got this. But Hector does bring an attack. He does bring something a little different in terms of running into that inside channel. He does not link up well with Pepe. They do not work well together on the right-hand side. And Mike, you can jump in here at any time with what you think on this. But I happen to like a little bit of diversity in terms of attacking style. The biggest knock on Bellerin, in my opinion, I'm all right with him in attack. His end product could be better.
His crossing is absolutely horrible.
But again, if that's not what you tell him to do, then maybe you don't necessarily need to worry about it. You know what I mean? Like, I understand that you want your fullback. Mike, go ahead. You've been quiet here for a few minutes. Go ahead. Jump in.
I was going to say, I think that's what he is being instructed to do, because when Tierney is on the left, he's whipping in crosses. He's taking on a defender, low crosses, high crosses. Bellerin, I'm going to say, at least as of late, for me, I think he's progressively been getting a little bit worse as the season's gone by. One thing that was brought up today on Arse blog, they referred to a tweet, and something you can take into consideration is this season, amongst all of the seasons, the players are going through physical and mental anxiety in contrast to other seasons, in the sense that they're playing every 3-4 days. You know, their mind has to be on the game 24/7 because they're playing every 2-3 days. So not giving him a cop-out, but potentially he might be less comfortable with that, right? Everybody, behaves and receives controversy or added pressure in different ways. So that might be something that's affecting his style of game. But to your point, Tanner, I was perfectly fine with the contrast that you brought up. I liked the fact that he was speedy. All that said, Pepe, obviously, Pepe got moved to the left. He got moved to the right this game, and we could talk about why. We might potentially talk about that a little bit later on, but I think in order to not be completely exposed and lopsided, you can't have both Pepe and Bellerin on that side. That's the beautiful thing of Saka, right? Because he is so versatile. He's so helpful that when Bellerin does get caught, we can depend on Saka. So it's a beautiful thing. One thing I wanted to bring up about Bellerin, I always try to be as balanced as I can. I don't want to throw myself at him. But so for those of you that don't know, I'm not a really big fan of journalists for multiple reasons. But I will say this. I clicked on the link, and I don't recall seeing any specific quotes. So I understand that very well maybe that he might want to leave. But I just feel like rephrasing it, saying Bellerin wants to spend the best part of his career somewhere else, Kanza makes it feel like, you know, I'm good, I'm better, I want to spend it at a better club. I kind of feel like it gives that vibe, and he's not in a PR situation where he could kind of seem that way. So when I read these things, I kind of take it with a grain of salt because I just don't like the interpretation that some people might take, right? That they might look like, who the hell are you to say, yes, who the hell are you to say you spend your better years of your career? So just, you know, food for thought on that one. I'm always kind of, hesitant to believe word for word on these articles. But Anywho, back to
you and me both, man. I'm with you 100% on that. I believe about 20% of what I actually read in terms of rumors. So
you see, the way the, some of the stories that I've seen, the way that they framed it is that it's Arsenal that have made the preemptive move to offer. Is, you know, they're basically the ones I've seen is Arsenal have offered him to clubs. And Hector Bellerin's like, well, I'm not fussed about moving. I'm not pushing for a move. But the club are kind of like actively putting feelers out. So who knows what to believe?
Yeah. And, you know, to your point there, Stan, that's a brilliant point. I think some fans, not all, underestimate the fact that Arteta's playing certain players. I don't think it's necessarily because, oh my gosh, I rate them so highly. I think it's, well, who else do you want me to put? Type of situation. So Bellerin was already established. Cedric came in with injury issues. Cedric started at one point in time, one or two games ahead of Bellerin. He did, in fact, drop Bellerin. Tierney got injured, started playing on the left. And so we're back in the situation where Cedric had a run of games. Maybe he got rested. I mentioned on my own podcast last night that I wouldn't be overly surprised to see Cedric start ahead of Bellerin in the Europa League. And if that happens, that should be some type of indication to people that the Europa League is considered right now between the City game and the Europa League game, the more important of the two. I think that's a massive shout for Arteta to see who gets the nod on right back position there.
Yeah, Ahmad Rashidi actually just put up something kind of interesting. Other people always defend Bellerin or find excuses because of his past ACL injury. Do we agree with that? I'm not going to make excuses for him anymore. It's been 2 years since that injury. I don't know about any of you guys. I think the excuse of the injury has passed.
I don't see it as an excuse at all. I will say I understand what you're saying with that with comment. I will say that I do feel, and here's the thing with opinions, right, is everybody has them online. It's a big present, and it's a mixed bag of everything. Is that I do feel, I don't know if you would agree with me on this one, but there are a certain portion of the fans that are kind of old school mentality. And when a player is dedicating any of their time to do something else, they're like, well, what the hell? He's a footballer. And so my perspective on that is he's a human being. We all need time away from our work. And quite frankly, I think he's entitled to do whatever the heck he wants to do away from the football pitch. So I think I take his point of view, and I understand that some people still use the ACL as an injury. And yeah, Tanner, we're past that point. At this point, either he's recovered or not recovered. And if he recovered and he lost pace, then you have to judge him as a right back at this speed, because you can't say when he was fast, because he's not. That's in the past.
Yeah, he's not fast anymore.
That's it. No. Not. So we can't judge him on what he used to be. We have to judge him on what he is right now. Right now, he's a right back that's kind of falling out of form, and that's just reality of it.
Yeah. Brian, what say you?
For me, the only thing you could really give him an excuse for, at least this far down the road for his ACL, is his pace. And to me, pace isn't the issue here. We're not talking about his pace. He can't defend. He can't mark. He can't cross. He does the same thing every time he gets the ball. You can read him like a book. To me, he's almost like a deep lying Iwobi. Yeah, he'll get you in the box, but he's not doing anything with it. What's he gonna do with it? He can't cross. He's afraid to shoot it. He always makes the wrong decision in the box too. And he's just not good. He's just not playing well. And I think we've done a good job. Again, sorry, Gary. Muffins. Muffins.
Earmuffs. Earmuffs.
Earmuffs. Yeah, muffins. Muffins. Wow. You know, we did a good job hiding Xhaka's deficiencies, and I think we're still doing a good job at doing that. And I think Partey is really accelerating that and really helping that. But he's been playing well without Partey, so maybe Arteta's onto something even more. But I think with Bellerin, it's getting tough for us to do that now, especially now with Cedric offering us just a different bag of tricks. You know, he's got a nice cross. He's got a very nice, powerful, hard, you know, a shot for set pieces, you know, for free kicks, for corner kicks, whatever. And he's got an engine on him. He may not be as fast as Bellerin, Although that's another thing I want to bring up too. I feel like Bellerin's like deceptively quick. He's or I guess deceptively slow. I don't think he's as quick as people think he is now. He just like prances almost like I don't want to say Bambi. I think Bambi gets. I know Bambi gets shot, so I don't want to say Bambi, but
okay,
is it Bambi's mom? Who gets shot?
In a fucking ballet skirt now.
I don't know if it's Bambi or Bambi's mom. And regardless, he just like yeah, he like prances. Like it looks like he's going fast, but it's just like I don't know if it's his arms the way he paddles when he runs. I don't know, but I know I'm Gary. I'm so sorry, Gary. But and we try to hide his deficiencies too by being really left side biased and persisting, you know, the Aubameyang, Saka, Tierney, and again working for us because Tierney is the man, Saka, the child, the golden child, you know, and Aubameyang to some, he's world class. So, you know, it's getting to the point now where these games are getting more and more important. These players need to show up more and more, and the deficiencies can't be. We can't hide the deficiencies so much anymore, you know, especially with injuries to Partey. And Cedric can't play right back and left back because, you know, he was covering for Tierney for so long. I think it's something we, again, going in a ring around the rosy, you're going in a circle, you know, it's something either we got to either put up with and deal with, figure it out, plug the hole, or we get rid of them. And then again, find a way to plug the hole, buy it, you know, spend money. And buy a player, and I think it's something that's going to be interesting to see in the summer whether he wants to leave or not. It's just going to be interesting to see what we do with him.
Stan, I'm going to give you the last word on Hector Bellerin. Anything else you want to add? I dare say I think you might appreciate Hector Bellerin more than the other three of us. So I'm going to leave you. I'm going to leave the final word with you if you've got anything else to add on it before we move on.
Well, Ryan's kind of ruined it for me now because the next time I watch Arsenal playing, Hector Bellerin's going to be there. I'm going to be sitting there going, look at him fucking prancing about all over the fucking place. What the fuck is
he doing? He glides.
Prancing about now. I don't want a fucking right back that prances about. So he's got to go. Get him out. He's prancing about right back now.
So we're gonna switch gears. After Sunday's performance, are we glass half full? We conceded early to Manchester City. We didn't concede again. We warmed up to the challenge towards the end of the first half, but then the second half kind of lost it again. Or are we glass half empty? We did have some decent chances in that game. We didn't take them, and we could have at the very least nicked a draw out of this. So, Mike, I'm going to start with you. You glass half full or you glass half empty?
I think I'm quickly building a reputation of being overly positive. Because I'm going to premise this and say it's not that I'm not disappointed that we didn't win. Of course I am. I just like any fan, I want to win. A tie would have been fantastic. I just simply analyze the game. I see the form in Manchester City. I look at them and say they're currently the best ran or the best European club in the world. I would say personally above, you know, you name me a club and I'll tell you maybe Bayern Munich, maybe. There's a shout, but other than that, I think they could beat PSG. I think they could beat multiple big clubs. So this is what I said in the past pod, and I'll say it this time. I believe 99% of the fan base went into the game expecting to lose. We lost, and I don't understand what the massive reaction was. We got dominated. And so there's two ways of looking at this. One, you could say Manchester City dominated us. They didn't get out of first gear. And quite possibly they didn't. I can't, you know, I'm not going to say no. We know the level, right? And then there's another way of looking at this, and this is kind of how I look at it, and I know that this is a little crazy to some, is I felt to an extent we neutralized them to a certain degree. You know, I'm looking at past games. I'm looking at them putting four past Liverpool. I'm three past Spurs. And we held them to three accurate shots on target, and one of them went in, obviously. So you know, a lot was said with Saka playing on the left with Tierney. And, you know, after debating and having conversations with different people, yeah, if you look at Manchester City's right side, you got Kevin De Bruyne, you got Cancelo, you got Mahrez. So I know, I understand that people are like, but Pepe plays better on the left. Yeah, but imagine Pepe defending one of them. So
yeah,
the reality is, right, the way I look at it is, I understand people are like, well, Arteta was more worried about City than our own game. With all due respect to those fans that I think they're slightly still living in the past, 10 years ago or so, 15 years ago, we're not the team right now. We're not that good that we could just say we are going to play the Arsenal way and dominate a team. I think very much so with the players that we currently have, we still need to tailor our game to our strength and try to counter the other team. And so for those reasons, the way the game played out, I wasn't incredibly disappointed. Yeah, Ray Anderson. Yeah. So personally, you know, I guess I'll pass it on to you, Stan, because I'm not sure where Tanner went on for us.
No, but Tanner just ran it back. I was just going to ask Ryan, right? Looking at what happened at the end of the game, looking at what the end result was, how did that compare to what you thought it was going to be going into the game? Basically, did you think we were going to get a hide-in? Are you pleased that we kept it tight at 1-0? Or were you one of those that actually thought that we were going to come away with something?
So this is going to be interesting. It's actually, you know what? It's a perfect segue. My beer of the week is Reaching for Treasure by Hoax. I can't say Hoax. Hoax Brewing Company. I did a lot of Hoax Brewing Companies.
So Reaching for Trevor.
Trevor. Okay. So I feel like this fan base, every game, they're constantly like, they want like, can't think of the word I'm looking for. They want, you know, they're constantly reaching for treasure. They constantly want like good things. I want this. I want that. You know, we got to beat Man City. If we don't beat Man City, we're terrible. And to me, it's probably gonna be a little bit different than my post game. The way I thought post game and what I talked about. I don't really care about the game. This game kind of a write-off for me. I'm gonna kind of in one ear and out the other. I'm definitely focused on Benfica. They're the best team in the world. You know, like Mike said, you can maybe make a case for Bayern Munich. That's probably about it. And even then, even in the Bundesliga, Bayern Munich aren't. You know, they just lost to Frankfurt, I think, over the weekend. So, but yeah, Man City haven't lost since mid-November of last year. So they're probably the informed team in the world. So, I said it on the Friday R show. I said it in the pregame. I think I might even send the postgame, you know, talking about like how, oh, this is our measuring stick. We're going to see where we are. And then we're going to see like how we could stack up against the best in Europe. I was full of shit. I don't agree with that at all. I think we did almost the opposite of Wenger football, which was we're not going to care about the opponent. We're going to play what we like to do, and we're going to just go out and express ourselves. We didn't do that. We obviously had a plan. Elneny played for a reason, not because, oh, we didn't want to play Ceballos. We're resting Ceballos for Thursday. No. Elneny played for a reason. He was the release valve for the pressure that Man City do so well. And he was going to be that extra defender. He was the one that was dropping back into the back three. That was him. And I thought he actually had a decent game. But again, and the people, you know, say, oh, how could you say, yeah, because you know what he's going to do. And he did a good job at doing that. He's not going to create. He's not going to score goals. He's not going to assist goals. That's just not in his repertoire.
Well, I don't know, Barcelona.
Yeah, that was, whew. And then he did it again, I think, this season, too, against Mold Dundalk. I don't even, one of the teams. But yeah, I think I'm setting my sights a little. This is going to, again, contradict myself. I think this is going to – I kind of want to set myself a little higher, I guess, or more I want to set my sights more long-term. I'm not worried about what we can do right now against Man City. I'm worried about the overall plan. Benfica is the most important game of the season. And a big thing for me, I'm not saying I'm going to be Arteta out. If we lose Thursday and we get knocked out of Europa – It's going to be real hard to defend Arteta going forward, like extremely hard. Not saying I'm going to be Arteta out, not saying I want his head, but you really, like, this is the most important game. It's all or nothing. This is going to set the stage for the next season and even the season after that. Because you think, like, okay, what's the best? We could get top four the season. Yeah, it's possible. I don't see it happening. The best we're going to do is Europa. So what is this, Groundhog's Day? We're going to get into Europa again. Up, oh, repeat. Arteta, Europa, keep going. And then what? We get knocked out a third time in a row in the first round of knockout games? No, we can't be doing that. We, you know, I always say, like, we have this plan how Arteta is the project, not the players. Arteta is the project. But sometimes, you know, the project just doesn't work. You can't just have this project. You can't have this manager plugging him. Don't sack him. We were getting relegated. I'm not saying that, but we were there. We were down with the bottom dwellers, you know? And we were just like persisting. But we're going to expect different results. We're going to get past the first round of Europa all of a sudden with this team that isn't really that good. Yeah, we got Partey. But who's going to want to come here? You know? And then you have that. And then you have that whole conversation, which is a completely whole other conversation. So to me, the Man City game, yeah, it's always interesting to see Arteta versus Pep, you know, the tactics at work. But I don't care. We lost 1-0. You know, I think we did a lot of things good to really put Man City on skates and not have them do the things they wanted to do. But in the same respect, I feel like if we had scored, they would have scored right back. Okay. So it's a difficult situation. But again, in a way, I think this game couldn't have came at a better time in the fact that, like, I could easily, at least for me, I could easily just write this game off and just move on because Thursday is the most important game of the season. And every Europa League game after that is going to be the most important game of the season. And I'm not saying I'm writing off the Premier League, but you have to start to really now prioritize Europa League and start really making moves there because I don't think we're really going to crack in the Premier League as good as we've been playing in 2021. You know, I think we're what, fifth? We're fifth out of all the groups. And no. Granted, we had that Wolves game taken out from under us. If we'd won that, we'd be in third. We'd be tied with Leicester, but ahead of them in goal differential. The only teams that are better than us would be Man City, 10-0, undefeated, and I think West Ham, who are like 9-1-1. So
since, you know, Boxing Day, to clarify, for the listeners, not if we beat Wolves, we're in third place, like overall. No, since Boxing Day,
and
we
so like
Wolves were in third.
The ending thing I just want to say is just, you know, and I think it just comes down to now we're gonna have to make tough decisions. You know, you have Eddie, we have Lacazette, Bellerin will probably be in that group discussion. You know, we're drifting away, you know, no pun intended, from the Deadwood, and we're kind of like, all right, well, Deadwood's gone, so now we're gonna have to start really making like, you know, difficult decisions. You know, some people think, you know, Eddie's not a difficult decision, just get rid of him. But no, to an extent he is. He wants to play for the club. He's a homegrown player. He's been with Arsenal for a very long time. They want to see him succeed. But again, just these decisions are going to have to be made. And it's going to be interesting to see what we do, especially if we do not win Europa League.
I just want to say one thing real quick. If Arteta picks all the players that fans want to play and we don't win, it's Arteta's fault, right? It's kind of funny. But at the same time, Matthew Hudson and somebody else kind of commented on this down here below as well. If Arteta picks all the players that fans want, it'll be 13 or 14 players starting. I disagree with that. It'll be zero because I'm not sure there's a player on this team right now that the fans want to see start. It's like all the fans want to see Messi and Mbappe and Haaland and Ronaldo and you know, they just want all the best. It's like, well, why don't we have the best players in the world here? And I say this like week in and week out. It's like, it's not FIFA. It's not FIFA. I know, Stan, you hit that earlier, but it isn't FIFA, man. But at any rate, I had to get that in. I just thought it was kind of interesting. Mike, go ahead.
That's difficult about, you know, those two last comments was this is, I'm going to go way back here, by the way. I'm going to bring up Shaka and the meltdown that he had.
Wasn't me, Gary. It wasn't me.
Yeah. I just feel like it's very difficult to get a balance of what the fan base wants because we're huge. We started off this podcast having a conversation from Bellerin. Two of us are split. One of them wants him gone. The other one says maybe we potentially keep him. That's the thing, right? So the fan base, if we're interpreting what we're looking and seeing online, you are never going to see the starting lineup get announced and be everybody's like, oh, that's it. Because somebody's going to be like, you know, why Bellerin? Why not Cedric? Why Mari? Why not Gabriel? Why Aubameyang? Why not Laka? It's always going to happen to that point. So to your point, yeah, literally Ray Anderson, we would have to fill 14 to 15 players. And even out of those 14 to 15 players, I'm sure there'd be 10 that people don't want on that pitch. I just want to circle back to one more thing about the insurance basket. And I'm really sorry, man. I don't know your first name. The comment that says, I worry about what it's we insurance. Do against the opponent. I can't make it. But the third division team league. So he's essentially, I think it's because Ryan said, you know, he didn't care about the game. I don't necessarily, this is my, from knowing Ryan, I don't think he necessarily doesn't care that we lost or anything. I think his perspective is, if we're playing a third division team, the expectations of a result are increased incredibly higher than when we play Manchester City. So personally, I don't think any fan doesn't like not care about a result. I just think that if you go into the games analyzing the opponent that you're playing and setting your tone of I refer to it as realistic expectations, I think that's where you could kind of determine whether you're going to be disappointed or not, I guess.
I don't have a yellow card handy, but it's a yellow for you, Mike. I'm
sorry, Gary. It's so funny. No, I
should have rephrased better. So I don't care about it. I think I could just
compartmentalize it.
Yeah, can't really say that word. Better, and I could just be like, okay, it's City. It's in between two important Europa League games. Like Arteta played not to lose. Yeah, we tried to get a point. I think we could have did a little bit of a better job and thrown the kitchen sink at them maybe in the last 30 minutes. But and yes, his subs were questionable, and I think that he did it way too late. But, you know, again, best team in the world right now. They're the most on-formed team. And we're kind of just – we're trying to, like, put our chin above the monkey bars for, like, more than 2 seconds. And that's a struggle. So I think it's just kind of like picking your battles. And I'm not going to go – you know, no offense to you, Tanner. I think it was a great title, the glass half full, glass half empty. It was a really nice touch. But I'm not going to sit here and be like, am I glass full, half full, my glass half empty? Like, what do I think? We only lost one nothing to Man City, but they kind of had their way with us. I'm not going to stress over it, you know? I'm going to stress over the game on Thursday.
I would say you're glass half full. And here's the thing, too. Sure. Like, I want to go back to something that Mike said, and Stan, I want to get your take on this. At the end of the day, I think of myself as being a pretty objective sports fan. I will tell you when my favorite teams are shit. And I think there's a you have to be realistic. I'm a realistic fan, you know. I think you are. I think Ryan is. I think Mike is. We want to win. We hope to win. But did we expect to win? Come on. I mean, you know, at least against City anyway, it's like, come on. Now.
Easy. Glenn was expecting us to win.
Okay. Yeah. Glenn, that's fair. That's fine. But I'm talking really. Stan, let me ask you. Did you expect to beat City on Sunday?
No, not at all. I mean,
now, hang on. Let me ask one. Let me piggyback that real quick. Is that realistic? Or because there are people out there that will say, oh, if you don't expect your team to win, you're not a fan. No, I'm a realistic fan. I can look at the entire picture here. I can take my fandom out of the equation and say, what's realistic here? You know, so like I said, I think you're just as realistic about things as what I am.
Well, we didn't get a hiding, did we? And I think, you know, everyone knows that there's a big, you know, a good relationship between Pep and Mikel. And it wouldn't surprise me if the night before that game, Pep rung up Mikel and he said, look, you know we're going to turn you over tomorrow, but I like you. You're my boy. So this is what I'm going to do, right? I'm not going to field any strikers. I'm going to leave both my strikers on the bench, right? We're going to go easy on you. So, you know, don't say I don't do nothing for you. Take it easy, Mikel. Bye, bye. Now you hang up. It was probably something like that, right? Because
I mean, love you, Schnuckums.
How do you field a team in the Premier League and have Aguero and Jesus on the bench? And I'm not talking like the Jesus, but, you know, Jesus, whatever his name is.
Is he the Jesus?
How do you do that? Really do that? In anyone's mind, you know what I mean? I'm going to play a football game. I've got two strikers. Which one should I pick? I know none of them. I'm not going to pick any of them because that's how I roll. I mean, you know, and if you look back at the games that Man City have won, you know, they've scored a lot of goals in their games. You know, a lot of goals. So, you know, on a serious note, did I expect us to win? No. And I have to say that the first 20, 25 minutes, maybe even half an hour, I was watching it and I was going like, can we touch the ball, please? Are we allowed? Like, just at least, like, you know, touch the ball and then you can have it back. It was like, it was a stark education and a stark reminder of where Arsenal are as a team that first 20, 25 minutes or so. We hardly got a lick of anything. And then we managed to get into the game a little bit more, you know. And I'm hearing that, you know, Clive from the Vision podcast went and listened to some, you know, Man City podcast to find out what they were talking about. And they said that of the games, that, you know, the last 16 games or whatever, it's been 17 games, that the Arsenal one was the hardest. But, I mean, if you're not going to play in the strikers, you know, I mean, what do you expect? But there's my sort of roundabout answer. I didn't expect us to win, but at least we didn't get a whooping.
I think, where is it?
And in the words of Stone Cold Steve Austin, that's all I've got to say about that.
So Gunner since 96 said like a perfect quote. He says, "We may not have expected to win, but an Arsenal Football Club is expected to challenge every team." Yes, and I think that's where people get lost. People expect to win. People expect us to be top six. Those fans are calling for Arteta's head, are doing this, doing that. Fine, I guess you have every right to your opinion. You think we're entitled to win the league every year. Fine, cool. But I do agree in that respect is we should be challenging these teams. And I don't think we're there yet to where we could really put up a big fight. But, I mean, I think we, you know, like Stan said, in their last four games, they scored three or more goals. You know, so to only surrender one, I think, is a win. And to Stan's point about the strikers, I don't know how well Gabriel Jesus has been playing, but I know since Aguero's back injury earlier in the season, he's been really bad. Hasn't been good. Hasn't been on form. He's been playing really, really, really bad. So I don't know. I don't know Gabriel's situation. So maybe there was a reason why he didn't start either. But and then again, to Stan's point, I listened to the same podcast with Arsenal Vision, and Clive did say that. And I brought the same thing to – I have two friends that are Man City fans. I said the same thing to them, you know, what did you think? They essentially said the same thing, and they essentially said what Clive also said, how they think Gundogan and KDB slowed them down, holding them back. Because Gundogan has been – they're probably their most on-form player, most on-form player in the world.
He's making a very strong argument for player of the year.
And KDB's just coming back from an injury, you know? Yeah. So he's kind of a little rusty too. So for them to say those two players, you know, frustrated them the most was very interesting and telling, I guess you could say. But, I guess it's any fan base really, but especially our fan base, they just want to twist words. Because I'm not saying that either.
Yeah, literally all four of us have not said happy. We've not said that we didn't want to challenge. Neither of us said that.
But I think that's the thing, though. If you don't think you're entitled to win every game, if you don't think you're entitled to win the trophy, then, oh, well, you want this. You want to be 15th. You want to be 16th. You want to be 11th or 10th. No. sometimes things happen. And I guess as an American, maybe I just see it differently.
I'm used to teams of mine,
more teams than not, because I'm fans of really bad teams. Shout out to BX Gooner in the chat. I don't like baseball, but I guess I consider myself a Met fan, as my fiance is going to be yelling at me because she's a diehard Met fan. As you see all this Met stuff, that's all Met stuff, not Arsenal stuff, by the way. But yeah, I you know, you go through phases, you go through rebuilds, and you're going to suck for a while. You're going to tank for that draft pick. You're going to do whatever you got to do and build with what you can. And again, you're drafting players from college. You're drafting talent that'll soon skyrocket you up. We don't have that luxury.
It's a much different.
And I think adapting to that is just like, I was just going to say, adapting to that, I think for me, I thought would be difficult, but I guess maybe what I'm really having trouble adapting to is adapting to how the fan base, I'm not saying just in England, but just how the fan base overall is, how like they want a quick turnover and they want to win.
There are entitled fan bases of American sports teams. I can probably name you two right off the top of my head, and I think we'll agree. The first one's the New York Yankees. And again, I know you're not a baseball fan, but the New York Yankees, yes.
I said it.
They expect to win every year.
Sorry, Greg.
I mean, not even challenge. They expect to win every year. For crying out loud, they have their own television station. They're freaking money.
They're this Manchester City of the Major League Baseball, though.
They are. Well, the Dodgers have kind of overtaken them. I'll say this. If I had to compare, the Yankees are Manchester United. Dodgers are now Manchester City. What's that dinging noise? Does anybody else hear that?
I hear it. I thought it was you, Tanner.
It's not me.
Is anybody?
Stan's smiling. He's got something cooking down there.
I'm kind of working and doing this for my missus's office, and our computers are just like ping.
Oh! I just didn't know what it was. I don't care. But yeah, the NFL. I don't know that there's the Packers. I've talked to Packers fans. What's that?
That's the Brady effect, essentially. They've had Messi on their team, the Patriots.
No, I'm saying the Packers.
Oh, the Packers. I'm sorry.
See, you got to understand something, man. I was a long-suffering Patriots fan.
The B name. Oh, no. Sit down.
The Packers, and it's funny because with them, it's only because like they won the first two Super Bowls. So it's like, the Super Bowl's ours. It's like, okay, I can get it, but they're entitled. You know, they do come across as entitled. So it does exist over here. Like Ryan said, it's just different because you get to a point in a season with your American sports team. And Mike, I don't even know what American sports teams you follow. I think you said you like tailgated for Sharks games or something.
Earthquake. Come on. Get it right.
I don't know why it's earthquake.
It's MLS.
I truly watch football. Soccer, and there's just the difference in them, and baseball. And so I was born and raised in Los Angeles, so I am a Dodger fan. And then San Jose Earthquakes, it's my local team, and the MLS is definitely new, so I just drifted towards them. So yeah, I do the tailgating of the San Jose Earthquake ones.
I don't know why I thought I saw Sharks. Maybe it's just the hockey.
I brought it up when you guys were discussing tailgating because I live in the Bay Area. I'm surrounded by 49er fan, Raider fan, Shark fans. So naturally, I love live sports. I don't care what sport it is. So when they have an extra ticket, I'm like, I'll take that ticket off your hand. I'll go with you. So yeah, so I'm not heavily invested as far as supporting the team in hockey. But I go to a lot of Shark games.
Oh, I'm so jealous. I love the Sharks, dude. Fine. Nice. I'm so jealous.
Yeah, at any rate, the point being here, if your American team stinks, there comes a point in time in the season where you just kind of accept that you're going to suck. And then you actually kind of want to suck for the rest of the season because you're going to get a high draft pick.
Not unless you're a New York Giant fan. Those I would say. Said Dallas Cowboys. I'm going to say Giants. Although the Giants.
Dallas Cowboys.
Giant fans, they'll go 0-14. They're like, we get something to playoffs.
I love the optimism.
Yeah.
I kind of feel like I've entered a parallel universe here.
Well,
what the fuck are you talking about?
You grew up with this. Growing up in South London, you grew up with this. And it was pretty much all you knew. Whereas, you know, for me and for Ryan and for Mike, we grew up with the draft system where if you stink, you're not going anywhere. You're not losing your spot in the league. You know, you're going to get a high draft pick, and there comes optimism again. You know, so you're like, oh, okay, we get one of the top five best collegiate players, and this kid's going to come in and he's going to turn us around, and we can build around him. Whereas in football, you don't get that. If you stink, you're going down a league. And you know, if God forbid there's anybody actually watching this show or listening on replay or anything else, if you don't understand what I mean, it's the equivalent of going down to the minor leagues, basically. So, you know, with minor league baseball, you have AAA, AA, single A, which is basically the championship, League One, League Two. And yeah, and it's a lot of money that you lose. So if you want to understand that more, watch Sunderland Till I Die on Netflix. That'll explain it. They do a pretty good job of showing you what that actually feels like.
It's a really, really long way of explaining why Americans maybe have a different perspective.
Yes.
On what people perceive as mediocrity or acceptance of it. I'm gonna say this one more time. I wanted to win, and the hope was essentially Guatemala FC. I love it. the hope was to catch them on the counter, because if we recall the FA Cup semifinal, it was almost the same game, guys.
Yeah.
They dominated us. They got more shot on goals. And guess what happened? We caught them on the counter. Just like we had 2, 3, 4 counter attacks, right? All through the left. That was the game plan. 100% that was the game plan. Saka carrying the ball and trying to feed the ball to Aubameyang or Pepe. That was the game plan. The game plan did not work out. I go into these games hopeful, but realistically thinking our only chance is a counterattack. Yes. Oh, dude, he's awesome, man. He's in all the chats. He's been super supportive. Another one. Quick break from the game to say podcasting world and AFC. I can't talk about other fan bases because I don't really relate to them a whole lot, but all three of the gentlemen on this podcast, Gary and so many other podcasts, have been super supportive to my small little YouTube channel that I started a few months ago. Eternally grateful. Thank you so much, gentlemen.
Yeah, Gary's a weird one, but definitely check him out. He doesn't like doing tic-tac-toe with X's and O's. So, no. But other than that, you know, he knows his stuff, and you guys should definitely check it out.
Stan, that was a very consternated look you just had on your face.
I was just gonna say, you know, Gary, be techie and right, isn't he? He does that. Listen, be like Ian, and check out his channel as well. He does his post-match reactions and that. And Gary, man, big up yourself for looking after the chat box for us.
Thank you. Absolutely, Gary. We don't give you enough credit. I don't give you enough credit on here. I don't shout you out enough. So big up yourself, man. It's always a great job that you do. We're glad to have you as part of the team. Towards the end, obviously, go ahead, throw your link in there so that people can copy and paste, and definitely go give Gary a follow on his channel. So we're at about an hour here, fellas. Ryan, you kind of hit it earlier. If we lose to Benfica on Thursday, is it Arteta out at that point?
I don't know. I don't know if I could actually say it, but I mean, if the board's not going to sack him, but right. If he were to get sacked, like let's say we lose Thursday, he gets sacked Friday. I can't say I'd be upset. I don't think any of us would really be like upset. You know, we say we don't want to be this revolving door of managers like Man U after Ferguson left. But I'm probably out of the four of us here. And I'll go six, and I'll add Gary and I'll add Rohan to this mix. I was probably the one that was really backing Arteta, saying like, I'm telling you guys, he's the project. Everything is getting invested into him. So I think we need to support him, and I think we need to just kind of hang on. It's going to be a bumpy ride, but hopefully there's light at the end of the tunnel. We're gonna make this happen. you know, but with that being said, losing on Thursday, I mean, I think at that point your project kind of goes out the window. I think you kind of just say, hey, the dog ate my homework, and just take the F. I think that's what you do at that point.
So before we fly over to the Benfica thing, one of the biggest talking points of that Man City match was the lineup, right? The switching of Pepe and Saka. We've got Pepe, who seems to have like been revitalized a little bit by playing on the left. I mean, he's a left-footed player, and I said from day one, why can't this guy have a go on the left? He's left-footed. What's the deal there? Can't we try that? And we've got Saka, who has been deployed on the right, and, you know, he could be played anywhere, but he really, again, seems to be nailing down that spot on the right. So I get it that, you know, I put out a tweet saying, like, the switching of Pepe and Saka is such a conundrum. And someone came in and said, you know, he believes it's because, you know, Saka had a man-marking job on Cancelo. And once that was sort of made aware to me and I was watching closer, I could see that he was sticking quite near to him. Seemed near the end of the game that he was getting beat a few times by Cancelo. But, I mean, so what's the deal in that? Is it a case where, like, Mikel Arteta was looking at this and thinking that Cancelo is such a – and obviously Kevin De Bruyne on that side – such a problem, he's thinking, right, I'm going to need someone to man-mark him. And he looks over at Nicolas Pepe and he's thought, nah, fuck that. That's not going to work. Okay, I'll have to switch flanks. Or do you think, as some people were saying, that it was a case where, yet again, Mikel Arteta has overthunk it? Is thunk a word? Overthought it? Overthought it. Not thunk. He's overthought it.
I like overthunk. I like overthunk. It just sounds, just rolls off the tongue. I like overthunk.
That's trendy.
If you remember the last time that we played them, wasn't that the game where he played Willian through the middle?
Yep.
And again, you know, there was that
fourth match of the season.
Is he really overthinking the games against his old, you know, against Obi-Wan? You know, if he's like the, you know, if Pep's the Jedi Master, he's overthinking it. So I just wondered what your thoughts were on the switching of that. Do you think, yeah, I get it, it's a tactical move, or do you think, you know, let the players find their groove? Exactly. Stay fresh. Too cool for school, as I said, and I've said before. Do you think it's a too cool for school move, or he's been up all night overthinking it because he's going up against, you know, the Pep, Obi-Wan Kenobi in his eyes? Or do you just think that this was a tactical move and you get why you done it?
Tanner, do you still have Mr. Gunner Thoughts' tweet? No?
Gunner Thoughts, if you're still here, grab that tweet and DM me with it. Let me know. Let me know when you do that, and I will put it up on the screen. Go ahead. Hey, Ryan, were you going to keep going?
Well, I
don't have it handy. No, I've my Twitter feed on my laptop here is updated. It's you know, 3 days in the past at this point.
All right. So. Well, essentially, Gunnar Thoughts, I really hope you're listening. You can send it to us. But essentially, what happened was Pepe and Aubameyang take up the same space, and he prioritized Aubameyang over Pepe, not Pep Guardiola, but. Ooh, it's beer. Made me a little hurt. Okay, sorry. So if Aubameyang is going down the middle and you have Pepe on the left, Pepe likes to kind of cut inside and kind of take that top left space, right? Aubameyang likes to drift to the left and then cut into the left. And I think to me it's just a
Ryan, 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 I have it right here.
All right, thank you.
Go ahead.
Yeah, well, no, I
want to wait for me to pull it up here.
I'll wait for you to pull it up. But essentially, right. I think a way that we could have, and we talked about it on the post game show, but I think a way we could have fixed that was just more or less, I think ESR should have played. I think we should have found a spot for ESR. And the way ESR drifts and the way he moves off the ball, I think is just so silky smooth. And I think we could have benefited from that. But yes,
this is my question then, right? I'm looking at this little flow chart here, right? And I get what it's saying. Then, you know, what was the other game where Aubameyang came back and he started, you know, his first game kind of back, he was playing for the middle. He didn't do that then, did he? He played on the left and he played Saka on the right.
So, but just my opinion.
He played, who did he play on the left? He played Saka on the right. Was it Pepe? Yeah, it was Pepe. So why did he change it then?
Odegaard.
In fact, one of the games he had ESR out on the right, didn't he?
ESR could play both sides. I think it's mainly because of Odegaard.
But you would think then that if that's the case, it would have been like that for a couple of weeks back or a couple of games back, right? And it wasn't.
And again, to Gunnar Thwart's point, I agree with him. And I agree with him and I agree with you. I think Kinsella was definitely a point too. I think it was like you're kind of killing two birds with one stone. You're prioritizing Aubameyang space, and then you're also man marking Kinsella, which I think is something we had to do. And I think too, like the whole thing too is the whole Odegaard ESR thing. I think that was a big play. I think that, you know, those moving pieces, Tierney coming back. We don't know how good Tierney was going to be. We don't know how much space he was going to cover from the field. So maybe giving him Saka that extra like defensive presence, that extra engine on the left side, I think could have helped Tierney. Because Tierney was blown out of his ass towards the end of that game. He was tired, which I don't blame him. So yeah.
Stan, for me, I mentioned it earlier in the podcast. For me, it was 100% tactical. I don't think Arteta said this to his players, but I think he went into this game realizing they are the superior team, and he tried to counter their greatest strength. And therefore, most creative players are down the right. You know, I mentioned it earlier. It was Cancelo, De Bruyne, and Mahrez. And I think moving Saka to the left to help Tierney was a sacrifice to our offense in order to not concede so much under their pressure and their attack. So I think this is more of a one-off thing, and I would not be surprised whatsoever to see Saka back on the right again and potentially roll left, because Mikey brought this up in the chat right above Lauren's super chat right there. That's ESR actually played out on the left. Oh, you highlighted it. There you go. ESR played on the left that game. Saka was on the right. Udegaard, that was his first start, I believe, and it was Leeds. No. So I think this was more of a one-off thing, and I think Pep is going to go back to the left. Saka is going to go back to the right. I know a lot of people don't like the idea, the concept of saying City is a superior team, and I understand that people want to go in thinking we need to win, but there's offense and there's defense to think about. We can't just think about one thing. And the way I look at it, and I'm not trying to ruffle up feathers here, we are not a good enough squad, especially with the midfield that we currently have under Partey. That's something that we brought up as far as our offense suffers tremendously with our midfield. I think we're probably like midfield partnership without Partey. We're probably like 14th in the league as far as partnerships go. And so I think he sacrificed offense for defense just not to get mauled, stay in the game. But I think it was a one-off thing. And I do think against a more accessible, you know, team like Benfica, for example, Benfica's having a pretty rough patch. I think we go back to what's considered normal, and that's Pep on the left and Pep on the right.
Can I just say as well, I've just noticed that we've got a new member, Lawrence Emmanuel, has joined the channel as a new member. And I just want to point out, had Lawrence gone for the next tier up, he would have got a full-size signed nude photo of Ryan for his bedroom ceiling. But you only get that if you go up to that next tier. So.
No, Stan, we decided against the completely nude photo of Ryan. Oh.
Okay.
If you've ever seen Borat, the mankini, lime green, it's Ryan wearing that in a rather provocative pose on the bed, like, you know, like one of your friends.
Well, girls. Also too, I took an alternate picture where I have Arsenal down the chest, and then FC on each nipple.
Yeah,
so. isn't that gold membership?
No, it might be. I don't know. I just take the pictures. I'm not the business guy. I don't know.
You see what you're in for now, Mike, joining the family here.
I love it, dude. This
is the kind of stuff we get into where we basically just make fun of Ryan being naked. I mean, you know, we want to make him comfortable because Megan makes fun of him naked all the time. So
Oh, don't. Yeah, Lawrence keeps saying
button on a fur coat, but I don't own any fur coats. So I don't know.
Lawrence is asking for a refund now. Lawrence is money back.
Can I get a refund?
Lawrence, it's tasteful. It's
money back.
It's tasteful. Lawrence, no.
It's tasteful nudity. Tasteful.
No refund.
Yeah, you see that? You see that picture of Burt Reynolds on that rug? It's kind of like that, you know? Tasteful.
Oh, we're off the rails. We're off the only an hour and 15 minutes in, and we're off the rails already. Yeah, I've completely lost my train of thought now on Arsenal. I'm not going to lie to you.
I have a question. Well, I don't have a question.
I just have Ryan in a lime green mankini right now, like laying, and he's like this.
Just Arsenal FC. Yeah. Listen, support the team as best I can. I guess it's not my question. It's Mike's question. So Mike asked us in our little private chat, and I'm curious to what you guys think. So he says, so do we have to win Europa? In the chat, I would like your answers too. Do we have to win Europa, or we're going out in the round of 16? Or is going out in the round of 16 more acceptable than going out in the round of 32?
Yeah, I only brought that up. We're mentioning going out from Benfica is potentially a sackable offense. So my question is that the same fill-in in the next one and the next one? Or like when is the cutoff point?
When is it acceptable to be eliminated from the Europa League?
Yeah.
Basically is what you're asking.
You won't consider like sackable, like, okay, well, it has to be at the out. That's what I'm just curious about, because I see the if we go out on Thursday, it's unacceptable being floated around a lot. So I just – is there any point in which you're like, we had a good run, taking into consideration that Leicester City, United?
I want Stan. I want your reaction on this first.
You know, Emirates took us to a final. Was that considered a good run?
It's considered a good run, yes.
Yeah.
Listen, here's the final. It was a good run, but
there are fans out there that will genuinely tell you, and that with a straight face, and they'll mean this, that they'd rather not play in the final, in the championship, in the Super Bowl. They'd rather not play in it than play in it and lose.
Timeout. And I was on this side, but I got specific about it.
Can't disagree with that more.
Okay, cool. That's awesome. My point that I was trying to make was watching that game and losing 4-0 was demoralizing, embarrassing. I was at a bar. I was at the Arsenal bar in Connecticut, and it was just – luckily, I got very, very intoxicated, but, you know, watching the game, I was embarrassed. I was embarrassed I supported that team. There was, I think, two or three Chelsea fans in the bar just going, oh, yeah, we win. Ah! They're going crazy, and you just see everybody, like, obviously, the rest of the bar, which is packed, were just like, we just lost 4-0 to Chelsea in the finals in Baku. And like this was our turnaround. This was a game. This was the story. This is how our story was supposed to end. We were supposed to win, get back to the glory days, you know. And I was embarrassed. I couldn't even tell you the emotions I was feeling. And yes, I at that moment when the full time whistle blew, I'd wish we were not in the final. I wish I didn't subject myself to that. Because it was embarrassing. I was embarrassed. I felt demoralized. But overall, I get what you're saying. And like, if that's, you know, I agree with you. I do think like that. But like at that time, watching that game, I was like, yeah, I wish we weren't here.
In the moment, that feeling sucks. But yeah. I'd much rather be. But when that feeling passes, I'd much rather be able to look back on that and say,
right,
we may have gotten our doors blown in, but we were there.
And I think Wayne Gretzky said this. You
miss 100%.
You miss 100% of the shots you don't take.
Yes, sir.
Well, I think that was Michael Scott, but
one of the.
I know where you go with that one.
that was good.
I know it's painful, but to say you had the opportunity to potentially win it, yeah. I personally guess I would take being in the final. 100%.
Yeah.
Time. Yeah.
I would, but just that game was just.
I know.
You got to be in it to win it. That's it.
Yeah. I agree. Exactly. Yeah.
So I just want to say that Wayne Gretzky is one of the three best hockey players of all time. He's in the top three. That's all I'm going to say. Not going to say anymore.
The other two you're going to name, I'm probably going to punch you in the jejunum, so I don't even want to know who the other two are.
Mario Lemieux and Bobby Orr, and that's not up for debate.
No, no.
Those are the three best hockey players in the world ever. Nope. End of discussion.
Nope.
We'll do this off the air. We'll do this off the air.
Nope.
Anyway, they're not here to listen to ice hockey talk. Or are you?
Not from I.
No, they're not. Yeah. What'd you say, not from Ryan?
I said not from I.
I thought you said not from Ryan.
That's okay. There you go.
Anyway, Brownie here. Hey, you got me thinking about the Russian girl when you said about getting doors blown in. Okay, fair. Whatever blows your skirt up, man. You've got to be there to win it, you know. So,
to answer Mike's question, this is such a kind of a cop out answer. But, like, I guess I got to be honest, and just the way I feel like every round he progresses, I get, like, less and less angry. Like, I get less and less, like, bothered, I think. So, if we lose the next round, yeah, I'll be mad. It's not that bad.
I think the further you go, the harder the loss becomes, actually. Because as you get closer to the ultimate goal and you start to see that light at the end of the tunnel and then to have it taken away, I think that's worse.
I think emotionally, yes. But
emotionally.
But as far as Arteta's job is concerned, I don't think so.
Does anybody really think he's going to get the sack if we lose Thursday?
Given our history, how long we kept Unai Emery for, which is way too long, I don't think so. But, like, you got to put things in perspective here. We're going to lose out in the first round again in Europa League. Like, you got to, like, just, you know, cut the music. There's got to be a point where you're just like, okay, like, this isn't good. Just cut the music. Like, be done here. Parents are pulling in the driveway. We got to clean this place out. The party's over. But it's the board, and it's, you know, we kept Emery too long. People said we even kept Wenger too long, and I'm one of those people that agree with that too. So I mean, it's just, yeah, it's probably not going to happen. But you can't really make a good case to keep him after Thursday. I think it's going to be hard to anyway. It's going to be hard to anyways.
I feel like we could do an entire show just on Arteta, and you know, if is he gone, does he stay, what's your justification for whichever side of the fence you're on with it. So most important game of the season on Thursday, Mike?
Yes, I mean, for multiple reasons, and I understand, like, Mikey's kind of saying, hey, it also matters how we play, but you know, we've been talking about expectations a lot. For those of you that don't know Mikey's wife, that's not a bad deal. Man's punching above his weight. Just want to point that out, Mike.
So are you saying he outkicked his coverage, Mike?
He's outkicked his coverage. There you go.
I hope she makes a good stir fry. That's all I hear.
It's a very important game for the season totality, the way, taking into consideration how we played and who we filled it against City. He essentially played that game slightly with this game in mind. And you know, we've been talking about expectations a lot in this podcast, and my expectation is my expectation I'm going into this game is we're playing one of the worst Benficas in over a decade, and we dominated the first game. That's the reality. It's one of those things where we dominated, we just didn't convert, and we're away goals. We have one on our name, right? Yeah. Home at Athens, so to say. So.
So if we're home in Athens, does that mean Socrates can play for us and Mavropanos can play for us?
I got a question here.
We should bring in Mavropanos for that one as well.
How is it if Ozil was still with us and it was a home game, but he still had to travel, would he start for us or would his back hurt?
Stan, you want to take that one?
I just want to answer a question that I was asked, if that's okay. Brownie was asking me about if I was sad that Charlie Nicholas got sold when George Graham come in. And you know what? I don't think so. although he had some good moments, I don't think he ever scored more than like 10 or 11 goals in a season. I think, you know, in like 40-odd games, back when he used to play like 40-odd games and that, it wasn't really enough. And the money that we got for him, you know, it did sort of like allow us to bring in a lot of players that would go on to be like mainstays in the Arsenal team. So I don't know if you're trying to compare that to like a Bamiyang, right? Because guys, I want to ask you as well. In that last game, I saw again a lot of people were saying like Aubameyang just does not look bothered. Doesn't look interested. I mean, it was only the game before that, right? I think in the Leeds game, he scored a hat trick. And now in the next game. And I have to say that there were a couple of times that I really noticed that he made some really nice runs. That I saw him. He makes some really nice runs. And whoever was working the ball up just did not see him or chose another option. And I did see that happen on a couple of occasions. So I just wondered what your thoughts were, because generally people were trying to say, oh, he scored a hat trick the other week. Now this week again, he doesn't look interested. His body language, he just doesn't look like, you know, they weren't saying, oh, he's not getting the service. They were like saying that he's the one that's causing his own funk.
I think in Benfica, I think he got into good positions. Odegaard gave him a lot of nice balls. I think he did not want to put the extra effort in to get the ball. I think he didn't want to, you know, go up a gear. I think he's someone that doesn't like to get bullied. I think he's someone that kind of wants to just, distract me with this ball talk. He's someone that doesn't like to get kicked and pushed around. He's not someone, you know, that does well around big burly defenders. You know, he wants to run into space, run onto that ball, get that nice through ball. That's why I think him and Odegaard are going to work so well together. But again, it comes, you know, against the right teams. I think Odegaard and Aubameyang are going to work really good against Benfica if they start. I think we just need to run at them and be like, hey, either we win this game or we're gone. These players need to have – I think it comes down to mentality as far as this game goes. I think we have the ability to win. I think we have the tactics and formation to win. We just got to run at them, throw everything at them. And I think Odegaard and Aubameyang linked up very well in that game. I don't think Aubameyang wanted to just kick it up a notch. I just think he was like, if I get to it, I'm scoring, yeah. But there's a lot of balls he just didn't – it just didn't seem like he was going full speed to. Maybe he was. Maybe I'm blind. I don't know. But
what does that mean, though? What does that mean for us in the long term? You're saying that in your eyes that you feel that in some games he just generally can't be bothered.
I'd say at the end of the day, like again, it's my opinion. My experience could be completely wrong. You know, he got paid a big contract. He's at his tail end of his contract, tail end of his career, really. He's not going to get another contract. He's probably not going to play in the Premier League past his contract. So I think he thinks, you know, easier times are ahead. So I think he kind of wants to just take his pay, score as many goals as he can, you know, within reason, get, you know, because he has probably traced some kind of goal bonus, you know, do what he got to do. But he's not going to break his neck over. He's not going to get a tight hamstring stepping up a gear to get that ball. You know, he's not going to go the extra mile. Whereas, you know, someone younger like an ESR, you know, like an Odegaard, they're gonna if you ever seen ESR play, I think every game he's played for us this season, he's always covered in dirt. He's always on the ground. His jersey's a mess, his shorts are a mess. He doesn't care. He'll put his body on the line for us. Aubameyang won't do that. Yes, I get it. Different positions, different players, fine. But if you watch the game against Benfica, Aubameyang is just you just watch him. He just doesn't want to go to the next gear.
That was the game where they sat him crossed in and he literally put the fucking thing on a plate for him at the back post and he just told him. I mean, yeah. I like that he scored a hat trick and stuff like that, but it's moves like that that I think that if you're talking about a world class striker or just maybe under the world class thing, especially for the kind of wedge that we're paying him. That's bread and butter, mate. That's for me. That chance was like that's a free one. That's like saying, do you want an extra goal for your tally? Have that. That's a free one. And he totally was. I mean, you got to get that, man. That's bread and butter for me.
There's something going on with Aubameyang. All right. So he missed. Go ahead, Mike.
Tanner, where you're about to take over, do you guys think the arm bar has raised the expectations that fans have for him? Because I personally, I see the same Aubameyang I've seen for over a decade. But now that he's wearing an armband, I feel like people are expecting a different attitude. And right.
You see the same attitude in Aubameyang that you've seen for the past decade, not the same.
He's fluff shots before.
He's not perfect. I mean,
fluff shot before. He never got stuck in before. He often, you know, Mikey pointed something out that, you know, in the pod that he doesn't give post-match. He never did this. None of it. But do you guys feel like the captain, the arm bar, might have raised that expectations on fans? And not wrongfully so on fans, because I understand what they want from a captain. But Drew, Drew Thompson on Twitter, you guys all know him. I think he's under Logic Killer.
Logical error, yeah.
Okay, so he'll tell you he day one stuff. Alba's not a captain,
right?
Okay, yeah. So right. Look, and I'm not. Gary's in the chat still. The ex player and Tierney have more of a personality
for that. Yeah. Mike, hold that thought real quick. Lawrence and everybody else. I was actually I am remiss for having not mentioned this at the beginning. First of all, on the YouTube channel, the same old Arsenal YouTube channel, Craig has disabled super chats. That's his call. That's his channel. We have nothing to do with that. But we also are asking, in lieu of super chats, if you would go into the link in the description below, there is a link for Tony Turner's GoFundMe for his prosthetic leg. In lieu of any super chats, we're asking everybody to donate to Tony's GoFundMe to help him get his prosthetic leg. So Lawrence, if you want to donate whatever you would have done in a super chat and just shoot a message and say that you've donated, that would be great. And I will be absolutely thrilled to put up any message that you have for us. So just go ahead and do that for us.
Failing that, Lawrence, you can just DM me your account number and sort code, and I'll just like sort it out for you. Like, you know,
yeah, I mean, put us all in the same group and just give us all your information. We'll take care of it for you. Don't worry about it. No problems whatsoever.
Name, et cetera, et cetera.
Yep. Social security number, blood type, firstborn.
Yeah.
Yada, yada, yada.
Favorite pet's name, that kind of thing.
Yeah, right. Yeah. What was your high school mascot?
Well, we really need to get to know the listeners on this podcast. So,
what's that, Mike?
Mother's maiden name. Mother's maiden name.
Yeah,
this is the important one.
That's. I said, if I can jump in here real quick on the Aubameyang thing, I said in the player ratings that I did on Sunday that he just his body language is all off. And what I had started to say before was his mother was sick, I believe. That's why he missed a few games back here a month or so ago. So I don't know what's going on there, and I'm certainly not going to make light of it by any stretch of the imagination. But if she's been sick for a while, maybe that's weighing on him. You know, maybe he's just, his mind just isn't there, and that's why. And, you know, I don't think anybody would blame him for that, you know.
That's funny. I actually disagree with you, and I actually agree with Mike. I think he's always, this has always been his,
the and way that, he's and, been. And I, and that, and I'm this saying, I agree with Mike as well, because his attitude has always kind of been this, I guess for lack of a better way to put it, just this kind of like pouty footballer that every now and then he just goes through stints where he's uninterested. So yeah, I'm just
essentially what I want to know is,
but he's always scored though. That's the thing. He's always scored.
I mean, he's scoring. Look, City again, we've spoke about this. I'm more disappointed in the shots he fluffed at Benfica than versus City. City was a service. Yeah. Right? He didn't even get the opportunity to shoot. Benfica, I mean, look, Bellerin laid him off with like a literal tapping. It's just the question to answer what Sam was saying. My general question is, there's a lot being said, like, why doesn't he face the media after a loss? If he didn't have the arm bar, would we still...
Arm bar?
Arm bar.
Arm band.
I think I'm thinking of like MMA.
Arm bar is a wrestlinger. Yes.
All Americans, all of, yeah. I'm just saying, if he didn't have the arm band, would that expectation still be there, or would we look at them in a different perspective? Because I've always had this issue where I kind of feel like we're you have a, I'm going to say an average six player. That average six player gets a 50K pay bump. And everybody's like, well, why isn't he playing better? It doesn't matter what he makes. The player is the player. You don't improve with the armbar again. You don't improve with the you don't improve with the wage. You are who you are. You got the wage because of how you play. I don't see anything dramatically different. He's always been a sissy in the air. So the fact that when people are like, "Huh, he barely went up for a header. Does he have a header goal in his career?"
Right. Like that's not his. Not his forte.
Yeah, I guess I just look at Alba for Alba. I don't look at Aubameyang like our captain. I look at Aubameyang like the person that got the armband because Xhaka had a meltdown with fans, and that's who the captain is. And you know, while we're on the captaincy, I know it was kind of unpopular that Unai Emery let the team vote, but the reality is a lot of teams allow the squad to vote who the captain is.
Here's the thing though, right? For me now, it's like you can't put the genie back in the bottle. What I mean by that is now that somebody's decided to make Aubameyang the club captain, even if it's weighing on his mind, and even if there's other players that we feel as fans would probably be better representative to be the captain, you can't take it off him now until he leaves the club. We snookered ourselves big time, because you know, when have you ever seen, you know, a top flight club just change their captain and their other player is still in the team every week and they try and, you know, sell it as for whatever? You can't do it. Once you put the arm bar band on the player, you can't take it off, because then it's kind of somehow it's deemed as like a sign of, you know, not playing well or not deserving of it, even though there are other reasons, and we all know that there are other players in the team that we think, you know, should have that armband. For me, you know, the left back is one of the biggest candidates for me. But you can't do it now. You can't put it back in until he goes.
Would your perspective of with your respect level for Aubameyang go up or down if he publicly came out and said, "I'm passing that armband down"?
Well, I'd have to listen to the reasons. There'd be reasons for it, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I'd respect the honesty. And if the player, it kind of feels that by not having that burden on him, it's going to somehow help what he's doing on the field, then I'm all for that, because that's what matters most. And I would actually think that if you think someone like Kieran Tierney's playing well and important to the team now, I think he's someone that is the other way. When he gets the armband, it's not going to be a burden. If you think he's playing at 7 and 8s, maybe most games, he could probably go to playing 8s and 9s, you know, because of the prestige of coming down from Scotland. And now there he is in the Premier League, captain Arsenal. I think he's the sort of guy that would relish the challenge. I mean, I'm speculating. I don't know him. I'm not on the phone to him every night or anything like that. But, you know, I get the idea that he's someone that would flourish by having that.
Well, I think he would take it as a showing of respect, I guess, for lack of a, there's something else. There's another way I wanted to put that, but I think Kieran Tierney just has that mentality, that attitude that you're bestowing an honor on me, and he'd be humbled by it. But he'd also want to make sure that he does everything he can to. I guarantee you that if Kieran Tierney, I'm not going to guarantee it because just I'm not on the phone with him every night either, so. Kieran Tierney strikes me as the kind of player that he would do his research on the history of the Arsenal captaincy, and he would see guys like Patrick Vieira and Tony Adams, and would study them, and
Theo Wilcott,
yeah, would study the important ones, the ones who did it right, and would say, "I'm going to do that now." You know, I would massively respect Aubameyang if he came out and said, "I'm passing the armband on to whomever, or I'm relinquishing the armband. Even if he just came out and said, I'm relinquishing the armband, and you know, letting the manager pick a new captain.
But I would think as well, someone like a Barry, and again, I'm only guessing, but you know, looking at the way he dresses and the way that he decals his high performance cars, I would say that he's very full of himself, and I don't mean that in a bad way. You know, some of the stuff he wears, I'm like, fuck, you know, do you not look in the mirror before you leave the house? I mean, fuck. I mean, it's like you just put your arm in the wardrobe, grab that jacket, shirt, and trousers, and you know, yeah, that will do.
Like playing fashion roulette.
Yeah, you know, the jacket's burgundy, the trousers are mustard. But I mean, what do I know? But yeah, right. What I'm saying is, like, I don't see him, because I think he has a big ego. I think you have to do the job that he does. Mm-hmm. That's a trait. That's a trait that you want in a footballer. Yeah.
That's a trait I want in a striker.
I don't see him coming out and saying, I would like to relinquish. You know what I'm getting at? I just don't see, even though he might even want to, you're just not going to do it, right? Because it could be deemed as a sign of weakness.
Yeah, he's not going to do it. And the one thing I want to bring up, and I just want to thank Mike for pointing out something that I had suggested probably a year ago, and I got laughed at for it. But the idea of, and I get the argument against it, and it's not customary in England. It's not customary in the world of football to do this, but to let your teammates select the captain. The problem there, again, as we've said before, we don't need to rehash this, is do you trust the team, the players, to choose who we think is the right captain? That's the catch. But when you have a team full of players that you respect and that you trust to do the right thing, and it's not a popularity contest, and like Mike says, most teams pick their captains because at the end of the day, you're not on the field with the coach. Coach ain't out there running around with you for 90 minutes. It's the other 10 guys are out there running around with you. So which guy do you want to look up to say, that's the dude I'm going to follow today? That's the dude I'm going to follow. I'm going to follow his example. And again, I get the, you know, trusting of the players to do the right thing, that notwithstanding. What if, and I was actually kind of hoping I would see this, last year at the beginning, or like I'll say, we'll say in the offseason this past year, reevaluate the captaincy. Aubameyang is not an Arsenal legend. And Aubameyang is not larger than life at this football club to the point where you look at him and you say, I can't take the armband. He's not Wayne Rooney. He's not Thierry Henry, Dennis Bergkamp, Patrick Vieira. You know, he's not John Terry at Chelsea. He's not any of these players, you know. He came in 3.5 years ago. He didn't come up through the academy. He hasn't spent his whole career here. He's not a revered Arsenal player at this point. Now, maybe that changes at the end of his career. But my point to that being, you would never have thought to take the captaincy away from any of the players that I just mentioned, because they were legends at their club while they were playing for that club. Aubameyang's not a legend here. That'll be up for debate, but he won't achieve legend status while he's playing. That's to me, that's just not going to happen. So I wouldn't take it off in midseason. And like Stan, you said, I don't expect him to relinquish it on his own.
Can I just say in ENN, and I love that name as well, and I think I remember you from the chat boxes on Sunny Unfiltered a long time ago. I know that name in ENN. I've not seen you in a while. But he mentioned that David Beckham, he relinquished the England armband. And I do remember that now. I didn't remember until he said that. You know, he did do that. So, you know, it has been done, but it's not a very widely done thing. So I think they're stuck with him as captain until he leaves the club.
I think you're right, but I disagree with the premise of it, because I think it can be reevaluated come the off season.
And I have to disagree with the thing of, you know, you're saying that other clubs let their team choose the captain and all of that. And I just find that a bit weird myself. I'm like, well, where does it end? Why don't you let them pick the fucking formation as well? You know, had a training.
Well, because
schedule is going to be. I mean, where does it end? I definitely think that, for me, this is something that the manager should be, You know, the captain needs to be, in a way, kind of like an extension from himself, someone that he can talk to one-on-one, and then those things will get filtered down to the rest of the lads, you know? Or maybe you want the captain to be someone that has that can confide in the manager and come in and say, hey, listen, boss, you might want to have a little chat with Mike. You know, there's a lot going on with him at the moment. He's had a few things going on, you know, at home. He might not be in the best of mood, so you might want to have a chat or keep an eye. Things like that, right? Because he's closer to the players. So I don't like all of this, you know, players submitting. And it's all five captains and all of that. It's just not for me.
Well, there has to be a hierarchy of leadership. I mean, because your captain's not going to play all 90 minutes of every game, and the rules state that the captain has to be on the pitch. Yeah, so you've got to have a hierarchy.
In Real Madrid, it's seniority. He who was there the longest is, and that said, Bellerin would be your captain right now. So that throws out Tierney completely. I'm just food for thought, just throwing that out there. I take standpoint. I understand his point of view as far as, you know, the extension of the views of the manager.
Oh, I agree with that. Yeah, I agree with that 100%. Yeah.
Essentially, I mean, crazy enough, right? I mentioned Bellerin. Bellerin was the sounding board, the voice between the club and the players when it came to the negotiation for a reduction of wages.
Yeah.
So say what you want.
I was surprised when I heard that was you. I didn't think of Hector really taking that kind of a role. I was quite surprised.
Yeah, I was surprised myself. But yeah, just I don't know if you have any thoughts on that one, Stan, as far as based on seniority, but that's how it works in Madrid. It's he who's been at the club longest is believed to be attached to the club more or represent the club values longer. You know, you can make an argument that Bellerin, look, you can say what you want to say about his footballing abilities, but I think he's one of those players that really truly appreciates this club. He's been with us for a very long time from a really early age. And yeah, the fact that he stepped in and he was the one that kind of was the buffer, that kind of reminded me what Stan was saying, you know, hey, the manager needs somebody to relay the message. And, you know, big up for him for stepping up to the plate doing that. But, yeah, that's just another point of view. Just some teams, some teams, first and foremost, I've seen it in Italy, you'll be new at the club and they'll give you the captain armbar. But Madrid specifically, it's about seniority.
I don't mind.
There's that armbar again.
I don't mind it when the armband goes off and I see Hector with the armband on. But when I see Xhaka come out of the armband on, or someone goes off and he gets the armband, it still pisses me off. It does. Every time I see him be given the armband or he comes out, I just don't think he, you know, he shit all over that back at Crystal Palace. I'm not down with that at all. And a lot of people might not agree with it. I'm a little bit old school, but I'm just like, no. Because for me, the captaincy, I think, is an important thing. You know, I'm one of those who believes that the FA Cup is still an important competition. And I believe that, you know, the only match on FA Cup Day in the UK should be the FA Cup. No other matches should be on. And it should be just like it was when I was a kid, where you start with the build-up in the morning, you meet the managers. The managers are sat in big leather chairs and they go for the team one by one, introducing the team and telling you a little bit about them. And then you have like a little bit of the captain. You know, I'm into all of that shit. I don't like it all being diluted down and watered down. And I would like to think that if you're given the armband at Arsenal, that it's not just a fucking gesture. Yeah. You know,
it should mean something.
It should mean something. It should be a huge fucking honor, like it was back in the Tony Adams days, that you're going to be given this moving forward. And I know that a lot of people don't see it that way. And you know, yeah, we've got five captains and the team picks and whoever's on. I think it should be an important thing. And it's almost like having the manager being on the pitch with the rest of the team. That's what it should be like. You know, if anything, as well, I want to see the manager shouting his instruction to the captain and the captain, you know, getting a team or, you know, what they're supposed to be doing, you know. So, I mean, I watched the football the other day without the crowd sound. They didn't have the crowd sound on. And I was laughing. I kept shouting to my missus. I said, "Can you hear him?" She's like, "What?" So every 5 minutes, all I could hear was, Denny. And I was like, "Yeah, if I was Danny, I'd run over and punch him in the mouth. I'd be like, this is like, I don't care. Just pack it in.
Stop yelling at me.
What do you mean? There's 11 of us, and I'm the only one. What are you saying?
You brought up something that I'm slightly concerned about, and something James Benjos brought up during the Manchester City Arsenal game. Pep just sat there, and all his players knew what to do. Arteta was pass here, pass here, pass here, run here, run here, run here. And then on top of that, you got Aubameyang, who is not a very vocal person to begin with. So, you know, rumors is at the end of the game, the very last game at home, we're going to have fans. And moving forward, hopefully next season we have fans. You're going to drown out the manager slightly, right? Depending on the noise in the stadium. So you're going to need a focal point on the pitch with the arm band. Yeah. There you go. Got it. Nailed it. Nailed it. I'm so proud of myself. Whee!
Stick the landing, baby.
You're going to need somebody on the pitch being able to relay the message and be in all his teammates' ears. So, dude, Stan, I'm with you. And if Alba doesn't want to drop it, I think what Tanner suggested in reevaluating the captaincy at the beginning of the next season, that might be a very, very smart idea to do. But yeah, I take all your guys' points. It's very rare if somebody relinquishes it. So yeah. Personally, if he did, massive respect for him.
I had massive respect for him if he did. Yeah. Yep.
I wonder if he went back and looked at Manchester City games in the first year when Pep was the manager, whether you would notice that he doesn't sit back in his chair as relaxed as he does now, that he was more in his technical area, barking orders. Because I think Mike from the Gooners podcast, I can't even believe I'm agreeing with something from Mike, but there you go. Wonders will never cease. But he makes an excellent point that's the difference between a guy building a system and one whose system is already built. You know, We know that we've got some dead wood. We know that there's going to be a lot of people that maybe going out. And, you know, Mikel, you know, it's his first rodeo. He's not in a – is he – has he got that luxury just to sit back in his chair? No. He needs to be in that technical area. And, you know, when crowds come back, he's not going – that luxury will be taken away. So he's probably trying to get it all out there now to make sure that his players, and the good thing is that what I like, it's funny because when you're shouting at people in an empty stadium, the players, they can't do none of that. Sorry, boss, what? Didn't hear you, mate. Sorry. Didn't hear you, mate. There's none of that. They have to do everything, mate. His whole bidding. And I'm not, we loved it in the beginning. There's a little bit of me that is, because I did notice it the other day. It was like, Danny. I was like, turn it in, man. It's too much.
Yeah, he is coaching too much.
Let the guy play, but you know, who knows?
You have structure and you have discipline defensively. In attack, especially in the final third, you need creativity. You need free flowing. You need free thinking. And I think Arteta has just built into them. Listen to what I'm telling you. Do what I tell you. Pass here. Then you run there. Now you cut back over here. Now you're filling in this space here. And it's too structured. It's too structured in attack for my liking. So, fellas, we're almost at about 2 hours here. Let's wrap it up. Mike, I want to thank you again for joining us. So it was good stuff, man. Good stuff for sure. So let's do final thoughts here, Mike. I'm going to start with you. But give me a final thought as it pertains to Thursday. Just anything, if you want to give a prediction, anything you want to give. You don't have to. Just anything you want to give on Thursday.
Sorry, did you say you're going to start with Ryan or me?
Oh, I'm sorry. Start with you, Mike. Go ahead.
Sorry,
No, you're fine.
For some reason, I heard you say Ryan. My bad. my expectation is for us to dominate this game and at least come away with the 2-0. I don't see them being very threatening. I don't think they manage a shot on goal when they played the first leg versus us. It was a kind of a wacky penalty. With modern rules, it was a penalty. You know, in past rules, if it would have hit his thigh and bounced up, it wouldn't have been. But all that aside, they were not, their attack was non-existent. And what we just lacked was just a little bit of luck. So I could truly see us just winning this game with somewhat ease is what I'm going to say. So I'm going to say 2-0. We're going to close it out. We definitely will move on. And hopefully, if we truly have the game under control going into the second half, we could maybe take our foot off the gas and, you know, ease up a little just with Leicester City in mind.
Ryan, final thoughts. Give me something for Thursday.
We just got to run at them. Yeah, we can't be playing the game like we were up 3-0 in the first, you know, the first minute. It's a new game. It's sink or swim, do or die. I think we're going to win 3-1, but we got to play like we want to win because we need to win. So it's just, to me, you have to play Aubameyang, you have to play Odegaard, and you have to just run at them, make those incisive passes, run at their defense. Otamendi is an accident waiting to happen. We just got to run at them and throw everything at them. You know, Pepe plays or not, that's fine. I want to see him play, but we just got to send our runners at them and just make their defense just a living hell. But, yeah, I think we're going to win 3-1.
Stan, final thought?
I'm really excited for this game coming up. I'm excited to see what the lineup's going to be because I think it's going to show you a lot about what Mikel Arteta, about some of the players on our squad and what their standing is, what their, you know, where they are in the pecking order, because this has to be right now, at this moment in time, one of the most important games that we're going to play. You know, what happens to our season after this game is going to be quite interesting, because if we're out of this European competition, all eggs are in that Premier League basket, and we are struggling a little bit in that league, as are a lot of teams. I mean, look how high West Ham are. I mean, again, I'm like, did I wake up in a fucking parallel universe or something? Because everything is like upside down. It's like a Mandela effect or some shit like that. the other part I want to say is my final word is thank you to everybody that came in and joined us. And a big shout out to an old friend that I've not seen for so long, Inti Anand. It's been a while. Going back to the sunny days, I ain't seen him around. Also as well, our friend Tony, he needs a new peg. Tony needs a new peg. Man's like had to have one of his legs taken away, if you don't know this. And these, I can't say the word, so I'm going to say these bionic legs that they fit, they ain't cheap. Nah. You know what I mean? They are not cheap. So if he can stick a fiver in, or even a couple of quid, or even a quid, every penny will help Tony get his new peg. So please go and check out Tony Turner's GoFundMe. Go to my Twitter and look up there, because I have it on my stream as well somewhere. But think of Tony. Let's try and get him a new peg. And again, thanks everyone for joining us this evening.
Yeah, just to piggyback off what Stan said there, the link to Tony's GoFundMe is in the description below. So definitely check that out. Please, 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 if you can spare anything at all, let's help a Gooner get back on his feet. No pun intended there. So. Yeah, I kind of meant that. So, yeah, that's all we got. My final thought is
Tony's just letting us know he's got a temporary one at the moment. That's like 10 grand. That's like proper Steve Austin bionic shit. Do you know what I mean?
My God.
It's not cheap, is it?
That's you know?
Stefan, link below in the description. Just click that link. It will take you right to the GoFundMe page. You can donate from there. It's self-explanatory from there. We really appreciate it. Last thing that I have is a bit of a selfish thing, but would love it if you're not already subscribed to my channel. If you could go over there and do that as well, I'd really appreciate it. Have pregame and postgame content every match day at this point. The cast of characters will change from time to time, but I promise you that the quality will not, unless it's Ryan. Then the quality is
probably. I knew you were going to say that.
I mean, it's just he's the ugly.
Whenever he can, he just sticks a knife at me. It's fine. I'm used to it.
He knows. Listen, I love him. Ryan, if I don't pick on you, it means I don't like you.
Ryan, you need to go to report him to fucking HR, mate.
I'm going to have to.
Yeah, Vince is going to tell us to fight it out in the ring if we've got a problem.
So. Yeah, I'll give you a nice armband That's what I'll do. I'll get you the.
Oh, give me a nice arm band. Okay. Yeah. like Tony said. Tony said earlier he wanted a cross-faced chicken wing with his arm bar.
Old school.
That's real old school. That's some.
We're talking Bob Backlund.
Backlund. There, I was like Bob Backlund. Yeah.
Him and Bret Hart went at it. Yeah. Am I tripping on that? Yeah, I remember.
Yeah.
That.
Yeah.
Ooh, the first time you could apply the cross-faced chicken wing.
Yeah.
I remember that.
Just search BG Media on YouTube, guys. If you're not already subscribed over there, please go do so. I'd really, really, really appreciate it. That's all we got. Thank you, gentlemen. I appreciate you guys. As always, we're going to get out of here. Thank you, everyone in the chat. Thank you, everyone listening on replay. We greatly appreciate you taking a little bit of time out of your day to listen to four yucks talk about the Arsenal. So we appreciate it, guys. Good footy talk. We'll see you out there.
See you next week.